Yeah, you say that I'm your friend. Help me find a way to bring me back to you.
Good morning, everyone. Just like to welcome you to Bowmansville Mennonite Church. Thank you for all your conversation that shows you're alive. And it's just a beautiful sunshine shining in the window. And this day, as we think about and celebrate Palm Sunday and the triumphal entry, just all the things that were going on, the things that are going on in your life last week, things you're thinking about for next week, As all that's happening, God interjects his presence into this situation, and we just invite you to participate in that this morning as the worship team leads.
I invite you all to stand if you're able this morning as we worship. Offering. There's also the My Coins count for the kids.
I believe he died and rose again. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you and praise you for this day, a day that we celebrate your son's triumphal procession into Jerusalem. But oh, what happened after that? Please let us always remember that Jesus is the reason for our season of Easter and what he went through for our benefit. We ask that you bless our time of worship today as we seek to honor and glorify you. Just pray for Pastor Ken and the words he's bringing to us today and all that you are about to do in our lives. We thank you for the blessings you give us. We honor you back with a portion of it to do the work of the church and our community outreach. We just thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to be here together this morning to worship you. And just want to pray for Ken this morning that you would speak through him, give him the words to say, and that we could just hear from you this morning and apply that to our lives. Amen.
All right, I invite all the children to come up front for a children's story. So, surprise. I have a surprise for you. Not what I was planning, but here is one. I just got a text that our team won the tournament. The Bible quiz team won the tournament, so that was a surprise. Thank you all for coming up here this morning. So, a surprise is something that's different than you expected. And that sometimes I have a surprise. I wear different clothes for different things that I do, and oftentimes wear a hat. And people that always see me with my hat on think that I have hair. And if I see them some other time and don't have my hat on, they think, you look familiar, but I can't quite tell who you are. And so it's interesting how much our appearance can change just by putting different clothes on or a different outfit, or if you add hair. That does make a difference. Other surprises we can have is, what's another surprise you guys can have? Logan. He got one. More dirt bikes in the garage. That sounds like it'd be a great surprise. Does that be different than you expected? I suppose it sounds like.
More tractors?
That sounds like something I would do. Any other surprises? Anybody have a birthday surprise sometimes? You get a gift or something, that's a surprise. So getting something different or not what you thought, I think about that sometimes when you bite into a filled donut. You never know what's going to be in there because, you know, my sister used to work in a bakery, so I know about that kind of thing. but you might think it's going to be cream and it's custard instead, or you might think it's going to be peanut butter and it's lemon or something like that. So even if you like peanut butter and lemon, if you were thinking peanut butter and it turned out to be lemon, you're going to have a surprise, and you still might eat the donut and like it. It's just not what you expected. One of the surprises I had when I was a kid, I love pumpkin pie, and my one aunt would always have us over for New Year's Day, and she would have pumpkin pie, but it was 1 year from the last time that we had pumpkin pie there, and I would always forget that my aunt put coconut in her pumpkin pies, and I don't like coconut. And so I would just be like so excited for pumpkin pie, and I would take a piece, and I would take the first bite, and it's like, look at my brother, and like, oh, made the same mistake again. So we can sometimes think things that are wrong, and we get surprised. So the story this morning is about Hector. This story was written by a blind man, but it's to still illustrate a point. Hector was a soldier from many years ago, and he had a little boy, married and had a little boy, and he loved his little boy very much. And so when your dad goes off to work, if you're there, he probably gives you a hug and, you know, says, have a good day or something like of that nature. And so Hector wanted to do that too. And so I guess this was the first time his little boy had seen him in his work outfit, because his job was a soldier and he was going out to battle, and he was dressed in his heavy armor and shining helmet, flashing in the sun, and looked very strange and dreadful. And when he put his arms out to hug his little boy, he was scared and cried. The father understood and took off his helmet, laid that aside, and then his son recognized him and came running to him and hugged him and kissed him. So, you know, it's kind of hard for us to think right thoughts about God sometimes. We say that God is great, and he's mighty, and he's a great judge. He's a king. And some of those names might frighten us. But when God wanted to make himself clear to us, he came as a child, as a man, and lived amongst us as Jesus did. And so there's this God, like this picture, the God who is our warrior and fights for us. And there is this God who is our Savior, Jesus, who comes and takes you in his arms. So I want you to remember that we as pastors spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to explain to you what God is like. We're not always perfect. That's not because God changes. That's because we have limited understandings. And it's not to make your life fit into a box. It's to help you understand how to have a valuable life because you're doing what God wants you to do. So let's pray. Father God, just thank you for this group of people. Thank you for all the energy here. And thank you for their little minds that can understand what God is like in their own way. And we just ask that today as we look at your triumphal entry that we can learn to know more about who you are and what your heart is. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, there's a snack over there on the bench. I'll let you guys negotiate that. I just want to thank all you who help make it possible for those children to be here each Sunday morning. I know from having little children a long time ago that wasn't always easiest to get out the door and get here and make that happen. But it's a great opportunity for them to engage in what God is doing, and you're enabling that to happen. I was met with a pastor from a small church not too far from here a week or two ago, and he was saying how, you know, the challenges of being the only pastor at the church and some of the things they were going through. But one of the things he said was, we have lots of children. And I said, well, if you have lots of children and you teach them about God, you will have lots of adults that know about God after a while. So it's exciting to see the energy that goes into Bible quizzing. And it's exciting when we win. We don't always do that, but it's just good to see that energy going in there. It's exciting to see people participating in Elevate and Before and After and Youth Group. Just exciting things of passing on the knowledge of God to the next generation. It's exciting whenever we have, I think upcoming, we're going to have a baptism at Elevate for two girls that said, I want to know God and I want God to be part of my life. That's exciting. It's exciting to hear the young adults asking, is there people from our congregation who will come to our young adult small group and just share about what God has done in their lives? And, you know, you want to pass on your faith, and sometimes you think you want to go do that to someone who doesn't know, and you think it's awkward, and how do I do that? Here's a case where there's a group of young adults that are asking for you to come. So if Derek taps on your shoulder and says, do you have time in your schedule? The answer is sure. Last week, Tony talked about the covenant between God and people, and in particular, starting with Abraham. And he was telling Abraham, I will be your God, and Abraham's descendants will be my people, and I'm going to bless the world through you. And so it started back with Abraham leaving his country, going to a new country, and then following God's ways, being different from the people around him, and being an example. Those people didn't always stay there. They were taken in bondage to Egypt when the famine was. They were taken to Egypt because of the famine. They got in bondage after they got there because they didn't leave again. But that was all God's plan. It was not a mistake. It was all God's plan. And if you had lived in Egypt, they were there 430 years, so you would have lived and died, and you've been all part of God's plan, but you would have never experienced the promised land. You would have been in that bondage time period. And so that's true for us today. You know, God is our God, and we're his people, And he's choosing to bless the world through us. And sometimes it seems like, do we always see the promised land that we think we should be seeing? And we want to keep looking for that. We do experience that. We want to share about when that happens. But when the answer is not now, we're still a part of that bigger picture. So how is this going to be? How are we going to be the best of the world? How are we going to be God's people? And how is he going to be our God? What picture do we have of God? What picture do you have of God? What picture do I have of God? And what are the things that makes that change from time to time? Just an example would be when the personal circumstances we have. When our situation seems very dark, we can get a skewed view of God because of what our personal experience is, and that's when we need other Christians to speak into our lives and say, God is not a God of darkness, God is a God of light. Today is the triumphal entry. That's what would happen today in history. And I want to just convey to you a little bit what I was experiencing as preparing for this message. I know all this stuff, but just in preparation, it became a lot more clear to me. And so I want you just to picture Jerusalem, that this is Jerusalem right here, where you're sitting. And since you're looking to the south, you're going to be all backwards. But if you picture over that way, way over that way, like over in Ephrata, maybe at Woodcrest, or somewhere over there, is another city, and that's going to be Jericho. So Jericho is to the east of Jerusalem, and if you think of yourself as looking north, that would be east of Jerusalem. So you're sitting here in Jerusalem. Over there is Jericho, and it's about, I checked it, the Woodcrest Retreat is about 8.5 miles from here, and that's about the distance from Jericho to here. And their travel was by foot, and I understand it took about 8 or 9 hours to walk from there to here if you were in good shape. So if you're in good shape, raise your hand. Okay, figure 10 or 11 hours. So it wasn't just 8 or 9 miles. It was also a elevation grade lift increase of over half a mile, around 3,000 feet. So they were traveling linearly 8.5 miles, but they were traveling uphill an extra half a mile. And that's a bit of a journey. I like to hike, but I do get tired. And that's not all. If you look at this picture here, so you got Jericho all the way on the right, on the flat, there were the lowest. And then up that climb, you're climbing up until you get to a little plateau, and then you think you got halfway up your half mile. Then you go back down, and then you go up again. And when you get to the very highest point, you still have to go down in a valley. That's the Kidron Valley that takes you up into Jerusalem. So I just want you to look at that highest point there. Right there is the Mount of Olives, and that's where it's a 8 or 9 miles squashed into about 6 feet there. So it's wider than that, but that's where the cities of, right here is where the cities of Bethany and Bethphage are located. They're just like neighbors. So if you think of the little one-room school out here on Pleasant Valley Road, that would be Bethphage. And then, out maybe at Calvary Church out there would be Bethany. So that's but between the little one-room schoolhouse and here is where our story takes place, and that's where it goes down and up. And it reminds me of when you go to Camp Andrews. Pretty much any camp that starts out, they start out on a hill. I think the farmers donate the land, and they say, we can't farm there anyhow, so you can put a camp there. And always over time, they expand a little bit and build over beside that on the flat. But if you're like at Camp Andrews, when youth group go or youth retreats, you go down the hill and up the other side, down the hill and up the other side. When it says Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, or Jesus went to Gethsemane, or Jesus went to Jerusalem over the temple, he was doing that trek up and down that little walk. So in today's story, he started at Jericho. And the thing that happened there He healed a blind man. His name was Bartimaeus. And it was someone he met on his journey as he was trekking the day up towards the triumphal entry. The next man he met, he met lots of people. The next one that's told us about is Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a short man, and he was involved. He was a tax collector. He involved cheating people of their money. And so Bartimaeus and Zacchaeus were people that Jesus touched, and I would say a soul that Jesus collected on his way to Jerusalem this day. So you have Bartimaeus, the blind man, who had a physical problem. You have Zacchaeus, the dishonest man, who had an emotional and a activity problem. And Jesus is trekking his way up. It's also in here, in this journey, if you look at it from, I was looking at some drone footage, and it's just barren. Like, it's wilderness. Up through there, once you get out of Jericho, go and get up on the flat. And so it's not the place where you're going to stop at McDonald's and get some milkshake or something if you get hot and tired. Like, you're just going to do this. So Jesus even knew where he was going, ultimately to the cross, but he was making this trek up here. He was still retrieving lost. And my sermon title is Still Retrieving the Lost, that's what Jesus is doing. And what I want to bring out is that this is the heart of God, and it's the heart of what Jesus was doing as he was on earth. He did many other things, like feed people, he healed people, he set people free who were social outcasts. He did many things, but he was retrieving lost to come into his kingdom. That's something we always have to remember as we are the people of God, to be a blessing to the world. No matter how long we are established as a church, whatever, our role is still to retrieve the lost and bring them in to be part of God's kingdom. And as we saw on Sunday school this morning, that in Abraham's and the Old Covenant, it was a certain people, a certain nation. In the New Covenant, it was all people who believe and have faith. So it was extended to the Gentiles. That's good news for us, because that's who we are. So the towns on that journey from Woodcrest to Calvary out there to the one-room school is Jericho, Bethany, and Bethphage. And when Jesus gets to Bethany, he's there at Lazarus' house, and we have, you know, the sibling gathering. There's Martha, she's serving. There's Lazarus, he's reclining. And there's Mary, she's filling the house with fragrance. You know, it's like that. Everyone has a job to do. So I want you to think about that. Everyone has a job to do at Lazarus' house, and everyone has a job to do at your house or at God's house here. That we're not all trying to do the same thing, but we're all doing our thing. Other players in the story are the religious leaders. We'll call them the Pharisees for today. There was some other names for them, but they were also players. They were all in the same area doing the same thing. There was crowds. There was Jesus. There was the disciples. Everybody doing what they do. The crowds were crowding. The disciples were questioning. Pharisees were controlling. And we're going to find out what Jesus was doing. Jesus was weeping at the point of our story. So turn your Bibles to Matthew 21. Matthew 21, 1 to 11 is how it's recorded by Matthew. There's also, if you don't like that version, there's three other versions of the same story, and so I'm going to chip in a couple of things that the other writers add that Matthew lets out. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there, with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." Now this took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. The prophet said, "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." And the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds went ahead of him, and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna, son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." I find it interesting that they said the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee and didn't say the Messiah when they're shouting the things that they're shouting. So some other color that's added by the other writers was that John adds that the crowd had come because of the feast. They were preparing for the feast of the Passover, which was going to be happening that week. It was the Passover was a remembrance thing. Just like in next week, we're going to be doing a remembrance thing of communion. We're going to take the bread and the cup, and we're going to remember what Jesus did. The Passover was a remembrance of the blood of the lamb that was spread on the doorpost so that they could leave their bondage in Egypt. And so they were getting together to remember so they wouldn't forget what God had done for them. Mark also adds that when the two disciples went to get the donkey, that they were questioned and said, "Why are you taking this?" None of the other Gospels say that, but Jesus gave them an answer in case they're questioned, and in Mark he adds in the fact that they were questioned, and they said, "He only needs it briefly." So, you know, a couple hours. It should be like a one-day rental or something like that. So, all that took place to fulfill what the prophet was saying. John points out that the crowds were there because they were there because they had seen Lazarus raised and they wanted to see what Jesus was doing, going to do next. Luke adds that Jesus is weeping because he's weeping because that here he was, God came near, and they didn't recognize him. He was also weeping because of the pain that he knew they would experience because they were going to go against what God's ways were. And at the end of the triumphal entry, when he gets to the temple, Mark adds that it's late in the day. So he was ready for bed or whatever, and it's like, Jesus says, Jesus didn't do anything else because it was late in the day. So those were all the things that were kind of surrounding, going on as Jesus was entering. But as Jesus was riding the donkey down the Kidron Valley, up the other side into the temple, they were shouting. The Pharisees were saying, "Tell them to stop." The Pharisees didn't like this because it was ruining their plans. Somewhere in one of the Gospels it says, "We're getting nowhere because of this." I'm not sure where they were trying to go. It seemed like they were trying to stop people from getting to God, is what it seemed like sometimes. But they were trying to stop them from speaking, and Jesus said, "If they stop, the stones are going to cry out. I'm going to be praised." And I guess I want us to come back and circle back. What is the heart of God? What is God saying? God's heart is to retrieve the lost. God's heart is that he receives glory. And that it isn't the glory that we receive. Comes back to when Jesus was listening to the 72 come back and they were saying, we saw people healed, we saw all these amazing miracles, and he says, don't rejoice because of all that, but rejoice because your name is written in heaven. It's really the only one thing we have in common to be excited about. Bringing other lost and rejoicing because our name is in heaven. So the words they were saying was, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And it's a prophetic thing taken from Psalm 118. So I want you just to turn there, and we're going to read that chapter, Psalm 118. By the way, if you want to memorize scripture and you're not real good at it, if you start with Psalm 117, you can memorize the whole chapter pretty easy because it's only two verses. But it's still a chapter. So the next one is, and then 118 is next, and 119 is the longest one, so you don't want to start with that one. But in Psalm 118, it talks about, in the name of the Lord, I cut them off. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. And I guess the thing that I want to bring out about God's heart is that what is getting cut off is the enemy, Satan. It is not destroying people. And the surprise that God's people had when Jesus came was, they thought it was going to destroy people that were holding them in bondage or making their life difficult, but God was going to destroy the evil that was going to make their life difficult. So they were, God's saving them from death, not only that, but also saving them for life, to be set free. So I want you to think about, as I read this, just like, what are those things in your life that you need God to cut off? It's not those people that have to get out of your life. It's what are those things that the evil that has influenced your life that needs to be cut off? And how can our God like in his shining armor come and cut off that evil that stands against us? Whether that's our thought life, that I'm no good, that whether that's our pride, whether that's an evil intent of some company or country or terrorists, all that. That is what God wants to cut off. He wants to retrieve the lost people and cut off the sin. Psalm 118 says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever. In my anguish, I cried to the Lord, and he answered by setting me free. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? The Lord is my helper. The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I will look in triumph on my enemies. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. All the nations surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side, but in the name of the Lord I cut them off. They swarmed around me like bees, and they died out as quickly as burning thorns, because in the name of the Lord I cut them off. I was pushed back and about to fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. Lord, save us. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done many things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done many things. Saved from death, saved for life. I added that. I will not die, but live. I will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness, and I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it's marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord, O Lord, save us. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. For the house of the Lord, from the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With boughs in hand, join the festival procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, I will give you thanks. You are my God, I will extol you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. He is our God. He will fight for us. He will destroy the evil around us. When we're ready to be pushed over and lose our balance and fall down, he's there to pick us up. That's the reason we get together. That's the reason we rejoice. Let's pray. Father God, I just thank you for your goodness to us. And I thank you that by your power, we can cut off the evil against us. I thank you that as your triumphal entry, as you proceeded toward Jerusalem, that you were still retrieving the lost. And I thank you that you retrieve me, and that each person here who is saved has been retrieved in that great act of yours of drawing us to yourself. I thank you that you're the God that destroys the evil around us that is almost ready to overtake us. And we go forth this week with joy, knowing that you are God and we are your people. In Jesus' name, amen. So ask the worship team to come up and lead.
Good morning. Now, if you're looking for warm weather or ready for it, got a great job opportunity for you. We have an MDS trip planned to Acadia, Florida for the week of the April 21st through the 26th. And looking for 15 volunteers to go along. And if you can let me know as soon as possible so I can get back to them, that'd be great. Thank you.
Good morning. I have one announcement for you. We had our members meeting Tuesday night, and we approved the minutes. And as we were looking at that, it says that my health insurance is Christian Healthcare Ministries, but that's not actually my health insurance. It is through Blue Cross. And so it doesn't change the minutes in here, but I want to be transparent with you as a church that that name on here is not what my health insurance is. So if you have any questions about that and want to hear how that all came about, you can come talk to me. Thank you.
All right. I invite you to stand for a parting blessing. And just paraphrasing from Luke, do not be surprised, little flock. Your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor, and provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You're dismissed.